knowledge seekers, welcome to an extraordinary journey through the vibrant corridors of education. Today, we embark on an extraordinary adventure as we explore the captivating world of class mammalia and insecta here at University of San Carlos Biological Museum.
I am Azalea Velasquez,
Krisha Nicolaine Ilayon,
Maria Thoros Rizada,
Dorothy Jane Kimiafar,
John Dave Hayag,
and Kath Babala.
And we are your Bioducators for today's video.
Get ready to be mesmerized with the wonder of nature as we delve into the intricate lives of these diverse creatures that inhabit our planet.
From the magnificent animals that walk down the earth to the fascinating insects that grace our skies,
prepare to be enlightened,
enthralled, and inspired as we unravel the mysteries of the natural world.
So we have here Mr. Fidel Bintanillo, and we are about to ask a few questions about this biological museum. So sir, good afternoon. May I ask when was this biological museum established?
Okay, so this biological museum was established in 1952 after the effort of Father Schulig, Heinrich Schulig, SBB. Through his legacy, we were able to accumulate these marvelous collections of insects, marine organisms, vertebrate animals, including the herbarium collections. And so far we have more or less 100,000 specimens stored here inside the museum.
So second question, sir, so how did they maintain in preserving these animals?
Now for the vertebrate animals like mammals, there are two types of preservation, either bottom specimen, meaning the specimen are placed inside the bottle to serve in formalin or ethyl alcohol, for example. Now, for the stuffing of animals, that is art of preserving live animals, that is in the principles of taxidermy. So it depends on the taxidermist how he or she able to position the animals into a live structure. For the marine organisms, either they are preserved for example, fishes are preserved still in formalin. Now, corals, crabs are preserved in drying method, so you have to preserve first using seawater and mixed with the water to preserve. Now, for the insects, the preservation of insects either ethyl alcohol or through drying method. So, insects mostly are pinned using insect pins and placed inside an insect box, which usually act as framed insects for the public display. So it depends on what type of organisms and procedure when you preserve the live specimens. And then the most important thing is you have to place the name of the animals, the preserved animals, and then where it was collected and the name of the collectors. At the same time, there must be a classification. So there must be a common name, scientific name, and then families or order, and there must be a very short information regarding the specimen. It depends how you display specimens which make attraction to the visitors.
So that concludes our questions. Thank you so much for
giving
us time and letting us explore this.
Thank you. You're welcome.
The well-known method of classifying animals is based on the presence and the absence of the bacteria. And there are two classifications that fall under it, namely vertebrates and invertebrates.
Let's go first with vertebrates. Vertebrates are more complicated than invertebrates.
Their main distinction is that they have an internal skeleton and a backbone. Also, vertebrates reproduce sexually. Examples of classes under vertebrates are mammals, reptiles, apes, and many more.
But right now, we'll focus on the class Mammalia. There are 5,000 to 5,500 species of mammals, making up a diverse group of animals that have evolved to thrive in a wide range of settings. So, some mammals, such as otters, seals, and dolphins, live in freshwater and ocean, while the great majority of the population are land-dwelling animals. They can be herbivores, carnivores, and omnivores.
All species of mammals produce and secrete milk in their mammary gland in order to nourish their young ones. And they are also a warm-blooded animal. Additionally, they have hair in their body in order to protect themselves during a cold weather, and they have lungs in order to breathe. In addition, mammals reproduce sexually. Once fully developed, males are capable of producing viable sperm that can fertilize the egg, which is released by fully developed females through a process known as ovulation. The fertilized egg may give rise to an offspring.
Oh, a fox! Well, as we know, fox is a great example of mammals. With the features of the fox, they have triangular face, pointy ears, elongated rostrum, and a bushy tail. So as we know, foxes walk with their tails because they are digitigrade. And also, foxes are omnivorous mammals that belong to the dog family Canidae. That's why they look similar to the domestic dogs and coyotes.
Another one is this monkey. Monkeys belong to the family Cebidae. They are highly social omnivores with a short, relatively flat face and without a great prominence of the muscle. Also, they have large brains and are known for their inquisitiveness and intelligence.
Lastly is this albino carabao. Generally, carabaos or swamp buffaloes are large mammals with gray to dark gray hair color. Their horns are sickle-shaped or curved backward towards their neck. Also, they are adapted to hot and humid weather.
Additionally, mammals play a significant role in our ecosystem by performing vital tasks, including seed dispersal, pollination, and controlling insect populations. They change the vegetation structure and the nutrient pathways.
Ladybugs and butterflies, buzzing bees up in the sky, teeny tiny little ants crawling up and down the plants. Many insects can be found in the sky and on the ground.
This song reminds us of the unique presence of the insects and how important they are in our ecosystem. So, these species stated in the song are all insects under the class Insecta. They are invertebrates, which means they do not have any internal skeletal and backbone. Note that all insects are invertebrates, but not all invertebrates are insects. They are also cold-blooded animals and can exist both land or in water. And classes under this classification include Cnidaria, Insecta, and many more. But we will focus on the class Insecta. The exoskeletons, number and placement of the legs and body segments, namely head, thorax, and abdomen of these species make the class Insecta distinct. Furthermore, they are the only invertebrates with the ability to fly. Over the course of their lives, insects undergo significant morphological change. For instance, they begin their existence as larvae and later change into the familiar shapes.
Insects reproduce oviparously by laying eggs. In a pair of ovaries, the female produces the eggs. During the mating, the male transmits sperm from one or more frequently, both of his tentacles to the female, through his external genitalia. In the case of some species, by having the eggs hatch inside the female, who then immediately deposits young.
One distinguishing example is this ladybug. In fact, ladybugs are a type of beetle that is often referred to as ladybird beetles or lady beetles. They are petite and often spherical in shape. Their wings cover elytra can be yellow, orange, or red, and they frequently have small black spots on them.
Some ladybug species are completely black. They feature black legs, black head, and antenna. They are harmless to humans and are frequently regarded as cute by those who dislike other insects. Moreover, ladybugs are thought by some to be a sign of good luck.
Like any other insects, butterflies are mainly the day-flying insects that belong to the order Lepidoptera. They have big scaly wings and have six jointed legs and three body parts, mainly head, thorax, and abdomen. They have large, often brightly colored wings and conspicuous fluttering flight. Their life cycle consists of four parts: egg, larva, pupa, and adult.
Last but not the least species that we have are wings. So a bee's body is divided into three parts: a head with two antenna, a thorax with six legs, and abdomen. Each has branching hair in its body and two sets of wings. Many bee species are black and yellow, but many are not in different colors, namely the green, red, blue, and black. Some are striped, while others have metallic sheen. They range in size from huge carpenter and bumblebees to the small Perdita minima bee, which is less than 2 millimeters long.
All terrestrial ecosystems' biological bases are provided by insects. They maintain soil structure and fertility, pollinate plants, spread seeds, cycle nutrients, control the populations of other species, and provide a significant food source for other taxa.
It seems that concludes our today's journey toward the world of last mammalia and insectia. We are so glad that you are still watching our vlog. Thank you so much for joining, and we are looking forward to more adventures in exploring our natural world with you, our fellow knowledge seekers!
Door.